statistics 115, 215, biostatistics 282. I know it's kind of confusing. We have four course numbers. Statistics 115 is the Harvard undergraduate course. All the remaining 200 level courses depends on whether you register through FAS, GSAS, or School Public Health. They are all the same course lecture-wise. Homework will be slightly different. I will explain that a little later. The course is called Introduction to Computational Biology and Bioinformatics. It's not just a statistics course. For sure, if you come here for statistics alone, this is not the course for you. We hope to teach people hands-on skills about how to analyze high-throughput genomics data, to learn about the algorithm, to learn about the experimental techniques, the type of data generated, the understanding of the biological problem, and how you can use the tools and also write some simple scripts to understand your own data or public data to make sense and generate hypotheses. Okay, can I get a quick show of hands? How many students are undergrads? Okay, how many are graduates? Wow, okay. How many have, let's just say, math or statistics background? Okay, CS or engineering? Oh, sorry, we are reserving first column for the recording, apologize. How many are physics or, sorry, how many are CS or engineering? Bioengineering. Okay, so how many are biology? Okay, so good to know. It's a hard course to teach and also a hard course to take because you can see the audiences are so diverse. I also came from a very diverse background. Initially, at undergraduate, I was a biology major. And then I just thought maybe I should take a CS course in case it's hard to find a job. this is back in the 1990s. And so when I graduated, initially I went to Stanford. I went to this medical informatics program because I thought if I can use my computer science expertise to help practicing medicine, that would be great. And so I went to the program. It turns out at that time, it was 1995, microarrays was just invented. And so I decided to work on bioinformatics instead. And so from 1997 to 2002, I was working at Stanford to get my PhD degree. And then at that time, I think genomics, the Human Genome Project was just sequenced. It was very exciting. Harvard decided to invest our investment in genomics and computational biology. So I got recruited to be a Harvard faculty right after PhD. I came in 2002, and I have been here since. Okay, so I'll tell you kind of the field as of computational biology, how it evolved. I hope you can see it started very simple. We didn't have so much data back then. And gradually, with the development of technology, there are more and more data and more interesting new questions that we can answer. And that's why this course has been getting bigger and bigger. So I'm glad. So bioinformatics started actually with aligning protein sequences. Turner invented the way to sequence a protein sequence back in 1955, and people were really excited. They started sequencing protein sequences. Initially everyone is a new one. Later on they found, oh, you know, you spend all this time, you sequence something. It became similar to some other sequence that have been done before. And so people want to see, because if two protein sequences share something similar, they might have similar structures and similar functions. And so by the time, you know, people started developing a database to collect the sequences that came from these protein sequence efforts. And so in the 1970s, when I was a graduate student, we all started our bioinformatics class with learning the Smith-Waterman algorithm. We will talk a little bit about dynamic programming, which is the key of Smith-Waterman later on. And so this algorithm, basically, when you have two sequences, it will try to align them and figure out whether they share something similar. Because as I mentioned, if they share something similar, they will have similar structure and potentially similar functions. And so that's the 1970s. 1973, the PDB is a database to store protein structures. Because once you know the protein structure, you can guess its function a lot better. And then as more and more sequences come along, a new algorithm has to be developed. It's called BLAST. And when I was a graduate student, it was said that this was the most widely used informatics algorithm. Okay, so I apologize. We have to reserve this for the recording. You can see that we're there. We do have more seeds, actually, over here. Yeah, so initially, every new sequence, so supposedly you have one sequence initially. You have a new sequence, you align, then there's two, you have to align for both, and then gradually this becomes 100, then 1,000, then the database continues to grow. And so now when you have a new sequence, the question is there a way you can find something similar to the database without aligning one by one? And that's what the BLAST algorithm gave us. And then by this time, the database has a lot more protein sequences. You can see the informatics people or computational biologists get more questions asked. They say, we have all these sequences. Can you see, you know, are there short stretch of sequences that are shared by many sequences of proteins? Maybe they define a functional domain of the protein, you know, a particular special structure that does a special function, like a carry out the special function of the protein. And so identify these blocks of sequence patterns that carry out the special function is developed. And then around this time they say, okay, if this is that doable, then imagine if you have a new protein sequence, like if you get the protein sequence, we were guessing, what does this protein do? Let's make protein structure predictions, because if you can predict the structure, you can guess its function. And so a lot of algorithms were developed. Some of them use the block database. They say, okay, let's look at this protein. It has a pattern like this, which says maybe it has ATP binding function. Okay, and then there's another block in here. It's like, let me just say, you are in a room in a house, right? You don't know what room is it. But then if you see a shower door and a toilet, you will guess, okay, that's a bathroom, right? So it's the same thing as like, if you look at a protein sequence and it has a block of this thing, a block of that thing, and so you can guess, okay, this protein probably does some function. And so at that time, a lot of people were developing protein structure prediction algorithms. And of course, every paper says, my algorithm was the best. And so in 1994, competition started. It still runs now every 2 years. So in the first year, scientists get together, they ask the crystallographers, because they really solve the protein structure. They say, are there structures that you imagine will be solved in a year's time? Usually, if the crystallographer already got the correct protein crystal, they will know if they can do the crystallography and then solve the structure within 1 year, right? So they say, maybe these 100 are probably going to be solved in the coming year. And then they say, okay, if everybody say your algorithm is the best, make predictions. We don't know the structure yet, they will come in a year, try your best to make predictions. And every group is allowed to make 5 predictions for each protein sequence that will potentially be solved. And then years later, the gold standard is out. They may not really have all 100. They say, okay, we thought these 100 will be there, turn out we may have 75. But let's just look at the predictions, how they do. And actually, a lot of people left the protein structure prediction field after this competition. Because previously, you can say you can do better, but now there's really a gold standard. But there are still definitely people in the field, and they are continuing to improve their method. It really creates a very good way to evaluate how you do. And then proteomics came along, which is, you know, you want to look at all the proteins that are expressed in a particular sample. At varying resolutions, you know, whether you're detecting the most abundant one or the not so abundant one. So I came to Stanford at 1997. My advisor wanted me to work on protein. structure prediction, which is this. I asked a lot of my senior students, classmates, postdocs, and faculty to get some advice. And they said, by 1997, they say too many smart people have spent too much time on it. At that time, time warping was invented. It was invented at Stanford in 1995. And so all my senior colleagues told me to try doing something related to microarrays. And so I started this exploration. So microarray was kind of the most exciting, I would say, high throughput way of generating data for bioinformatics or computational biology. Normally we say, ideally we want to measure protein level. All of our body, the different cells have pretty much the same DNA, but of course your skin, your liver, your bones, your all blood, all very, very different. It's because of the proteins expressed in the different cells are very different. And ideally you want to figure out what kind of genes are expressed in the different conditions, what happens when the cell is stimulated with a drug or some other a heat, and also what happens when disease happens, right? So previously, people, you can measure a gene one at a time and do a qPCR experiment to measure one gene at a time. And remember, in 96, when my advisor, my undergraduate advisor, came back from a conference, and he was so excited. He said, oh, people can measure hundreds of genes expression at the same time. At that time, they used a membrane. And then they hand dot these little dots on here. Each dot will measure the expression of one gene in that sample. And that's at the very, very early day of microarray. By the time I went to Stanford, it's much better. And a couple of years later, this gene chip became the standard. So the chip is this big. You inject your RNA sample in there. Well, it's actually converted into a DNA. And then, so this on the microarray, actually, if you look inside, there are actually many, many little probes. So each RNA, so each probe will have the ability to hybridize with a particular RNA sequence that you put in there. And that region, because the RNA you put in is labeled, is fluorescently labeled. And so they will stack to a particular location on this microarray. And at the end, if you shine lights onto this microarray, the regions that have the RNA hybridizing to it will be brighter. Whereas if there's no RNA hybridizing to this area, it will be darker. The very early microarrays are like this. It was kind of like a glass slide. You put different spots on it. And very often in the early days, people put two samples, say a normal sample and a diseased sample, one labeled red and the other labeled green. And then they put the two samples together and every spot is one gene. If you see something being yellow, it means that the two samples are expressed at a similar level. If it's red, it means it's expressed more in that red sample. If it's green, it means it's expressed more in the green sample. And if it's dark, it means it's lowly expressed in both samples. Okay. So this is a way that can allow people to investigate the expression of thousands of genes, now tens of thousands of genes. And so it was very, very exciting. By the time I went to Stanford, everybody thinking, can we do some microarray experiment? It was really cool that we didn't have to work, if we're a biologist, not have to work all weekend and still get your papers published. Because you really learn a lot. Instead of one gene at a time, you really learn everything together. Okay. So at that time, actually, Harvard has a pioneer, he's still at Harvard. Tal Golub is at the Broad Institute of Harvard at MIT, also at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. He used this microarray to investigate a cancer problem. So he looked at two types of leukemia patients. One is called ALL, the other is called AML. So for pathology, if you just look at the pathology slides, they look quite similar, and it might be tricky to diagnose. And the treatment for these two cancers are quite different. The question is, if we can do a microarray, can we get a better diagnosis? Then we can treat the patient with the right drug. This is kind of very, very early precision medicine, right? You want to reach the correct diagnosis and also treat the patient with the right drug. And so they did this microarray experiment. This is the company, Affymetrix microarray at the time. So they actually invested all the genes in the human genome, about 20,000 genes. And so each column here is a different patient. Red means, each row means is a different gene. They did look at 20,000 genes, but at the end, there are about, you know, these 40-50 genes that they felt were interesting. This first group, you can see, so red means this gene is expressed very high in that particular patient sample. Okay, and so they can see that these genes, so the genes listed on the right, they are, in a lot of patients, more highly expressed in the ALL patient, but lowly expressed in the AML patient. Whereas in another group of patients, in another group of genes, they are lowly expressed in the ALL samples, but highly expressed in the AML samples. Therefore, there is a hope. If you have a new patient coming in, you take their blood sample, because of leukemia, you take their blood sample, you isolate the RNA, you put on a microarray, and you look at these 50 genes. And based on whether these 50 genes are high or low, you can reach a correct diagnosis whether the patient is ALL or AML. Okay? So this is now a very simplified question. First of all, the microarray data, how did you really get from, you know, this microarray data to this heat map that you can look at? We will cover this material in this class right now. And also, how do you identify those genes that are highly or lowly expressed in the two different groups? Right? That's kind of a bioinformatics problem. And the third is, if you have a new sample coming in, can you correctly classify this patient as AML or ALL patient? Okay, that's a classification problem. We'll also be teaching you about this. So when microarray was first invented, this type of microarray was very popular because graduate students can use some machine. You write a program, you can make the little robots to spot the array. You make like 200 arrays, you store them. Every time you use an experiment, you process 5 or 10 samples, right? And so it's easy, but also and also fairly inexpensive. At the same time, the array on the top, in the beginning, I think it's like $2,000 a sample. The bottom one is like maybe $50 a sample. So everybody does this bottom experiment. However, the next time you find, I did the first samples from the arrays I got from the first graduate students, but this second graduate student also printed some array. I need to process more samples. He ran out, so I try again. It's different. And the results are not comparable. Right, it's difficult. So over time, interestingly, that microarray also become cheaper and cheaper. Nowadays, you can get Affymetrix arrays, depending on how many genes you are investigating, a few hundred dollars, maybe like $200-$300 you can get an array now. And so gradually, people go from the handmade little array to the more commercialized, because with Affymetrix array, pretty much every array comes in, it's always the same, you can compare a result. It's still quite expensive, but the microarrays today, so I would say right now in academic research institutions, people don't use microarrays anymore because there's a new like a high throughput platform. But at the Broad Institute, actually Todd Golub, the scientist who did this research, he actually is doing this connective bitmap project. So the idea was more and more microarray data was being generated, and they, in order to get your paper submitted, a lot of journals now require you to submit the data to a central repository. And over time, this big database has so many microarrays, and so the scientists in the Broad thought, okay, if we only investigate 1,000 genes expression level, can we impute the remaining 20,000 genes? And they can actually do a fairly good job. There is a new technology called Luminex. You can measure about 1,000 genes expression level fairly inexpensively. They can do this, I think, less than a dollar a piece. so it's much, much cheaper. And with the 1,000 genes, you can measure them. Then there's a computational algorithm to say, based on the whole public expression profiles, because those measured all 20,000 genes, if we only have the 10,000 genes, can we guess what happens to the remaining 19,000? And they can do this imputation. And so, and now if you have, they are doing this connectivity map now. They have already generated a million expression profiles. When they get rid of a gene, where they perturb the cell with a drug, you can test on these different compound libraries. You can test every drug on some cell, and every time you process, you generate this, $1 million expression profile. So they can test hundreds of or thousands of different drugs, right? And you can also use it to test the disease expression. It won't really give you the most accurate expression, but it will at least give you some idea whether this drug is promising or completely crazy, right? So you can, with 1,000 genes, you can measure a lot. And so that's kind of the microarray, or microarray still in use nowadays. It's from $2,000 to like $1 a piece, right? So you can get a good measurement, which is really exciting. So this camera actually terminates every 30 minutes. So can you press that red button on the top?